So, what is scouting? Scouting is the simple act of strategizing in terms of individual robots, collecting all the metrics of how the robots perform on and off the field, how the teams perform with your robot and with your drive team. Scouting can happen in the pits, in the stands. It's a very crucial act to be able to say that one team is good at climbing, but this team can really do the switch well and scale well in comparison to how your robot performs, so you can have a comprehensive alliance. So with the advent of all the competition streams now available throughout the country and throughout the world at this point, and the Blue Alliance and other scouting alliances, I know there's the PMW Scouting Alliance, and then in New England, of course, we have a strong emphasis on the Green Alliance. There's Open Scout. There's a lot of ways to get data before the event, and this is crucial to understanding how to compete effectively throughout the season. Even at events that you're not going to, pre-competition scouting allows you to better understand how you can effectively compete in the events. So even before coming to, especially an event like Worlds or even District Championships, it's important to be able to see all the teams that you haven't competed with yet, to see how they handle the scale, how they handle the switch. And it's also, in terms of that, it's beneficial for smaller teams. If you can't afford to have students scout in the stands and in the pits, being able to look at all that data beforehand is good. And even for events that are at, especially this year, the New England District Championship, with all the data that we had, it was monumental to be able to have data from over 7 or 8 events out of all the 11 events to look back and say, this team has been doing better and better throughout the season. They're a good sleeper pick, per se. So that's very important. Beyond pre-competition scouting, of course, once you get to the event, you want to go even farther into that. So you have mass scouting. So that's basically seeing this one particular robot, so for example, 4909, how do they perform on the field? In terms of how many cubes can they put on the scale, how many cubes can they put on the switch, how do they contribute to their alliance, and how can your team work with them? In addition to that, you also want to see how their drag teams work cohesively, if they're a team that you would want to work with in the elimination rounds. That is significant in terms of all the competition. So in getting all this data isn't easy. So there's two basic types of mass scouting we have now. You have, on the more cost-effective end, you have paper scouting, which a lot of teams end up starting with. And to be honest, it's very flexible. However, that same trait makes it very hard to analyze. There's many ways to do paper scouting. A lot of teams just end up printing one sheet per team or one sheet per match, and they just have scouts fill in the exact tally marks, the exact amount of cubes they pick up off the floor, put up the scale, switch, climb, etc. However, as I said, paper, it's hard to tabulate. It might be usable for a lot of eliminations, but it's very difficult to go real time to see how teams are performing from match to match and to provide your drag team crucial data for their match strategy. So on the other hand, you have electronic scouting, which allows you to view the same trends and predictions very easily. And in many cases, it can be made real time using Bluetooth or cellular. The only cons to this is, of course, it takes much more time to develop an app in comparison to a Word doc, and it's slightly more expensive. And just in terms of the cost, our team has spent about $500 to have a full-fledged system. It's much more than just the tablets. You have the tablets, and then, of course, you need to make sure you can charge them on the stands, because inevitably that's bound to happen otherwise. So all that considered, electronic scouting is great, but it's important to find what works best for your team. And, of course, there's always the possibility for middle ground. There are teams that start off with paper scouting and have individual match entries put in, and then have special scouts translate all of that into something like Excel or Tableau, so they can look back at that data again just to see the trends. And there's also pit scouting. Traditionally, a lot of teams use this as a way to go up and just get to know them and try to get more data. I don't think the data that you get from pit scouting is as significant as just talking to those teams. Being able to talk to the drive team, understand their strategy, get in their mind, and see how their robot and them perform is crucial. And there's also all these trends that you can spot in match data that you can talk to them about. Say, Team 499's climber was working flawlessly throughout the first day of the competition, and then suddenly in the match data that you have, you're seeing a decline in the amount of climbs that they're doing, or they're not climbing at all. That's important to know. That's important to go ask them, hey, what's going on? Is there something we can help with? It's a great way to get to know the team and try to understand what's going on with them. And perhaps you may be able to help them turn around, and it might be a great alliance selection. And if you have the scouts, it's also great to talk to them about their design, especially earlier on in the season. And like week one or two events, it's completely plausible for you to go talk to other teams to better understand their design decisions and be able to implement that within your own team using the withholding allowance. And of course, scouting is great, and it's a lot of it is about being able to perform well at the competition, but it's more than just that. It's being able to compete effectively and to bring your team to the next level. As far as scouting team goes, that's something that's up to the team. On Team 499, we have a singular scouting captain, so that's who's responsible for putting together the pick list for the eliminations round, putting together all of the scouts. So we have 6 scouts in the match, 3 red, 3 blue, of course, as everyone would expect. So that we try to cycle very often, just to reduce the turnover and to increase the accuracy of our scouts. So maybe in shifts of 8, depending on the event. And of course, pit scouts. That's very important. I've sent out up to 4 or 5 pit scouts at any given point just to be able to analyze how these teams are performing to get a deeper insight. The data only goes so far. So, as I said, using the scouting data, that is an even more difficult task. It's very crucial, and it's imperative to be able to do that effectively to compete up to, especially at the higher levels of play. As you can see at the World Championship here, there's lots of teams doing really well, and a lot of them have all the scouting data backing them up for their match strategy. So, in terms of match strategy, you want to be able to play on the strengths of your alliance and the weaknesses of your opponents, as in any match strategy. So this could mean, so for this year, knowing that your opponents are really good on the scale, but that with effective preparation and doing the vault and the switch, your alliance has a chance at winning them out. And in terms of last year, that could mean knowing that your opponents could do fuel, but you can't, but at the same time, you could possibly get to the fourth rotor. So there's a lot of strategy that you can think about in that way, and how the different alliances could work together. In addition to that, prior to your matches, especially in the qualifications round, when it's going back to back and it's all random, you want to be able to know how all of the robots in your future matches are. You want to be able to talk to them, figure out what, especially with the pit scouting stuff, you want to be able to talk to them, understand if there's any issues going on with their bot, and get them back up before the match. So especially at our most recent competition, that ended up being very useful as one of the teams had a comms issue in their last match, and we ended up going up and helping them fix that, which gave them a really quick turnaround coming back into the match with us. So the scouting captain on our team, what we do is we have them give scouting strategy recommendations to the drive team, and the drive coach in particular, because a lot of times the drive team is already strategized prior to match, and that's very important. But going into the match strategy meetings uninformed isn't as good. Having access to all this data, being able to say, Team 4909 can do 8 cubes on the scale, and then 125 can do four cubes, for example. Being able to go in and say the red alliance can do 12 cubes while the blue alliance can do 13, that breakdown is very important. It can tell you where to focus your energy throughout the mass and being able to go through the motions. So pick list, that's another very important thing. That is up to your team. This is something you should start considering before you even come to the competition. What you would like in a first pick, second pick, and up here, even a backup bot. So that you can do in terms of two pick lists. That's something many teams do. Their first picks might be another scale bot. Their second pick might be a switch bot, a switch and exchange bot. For a backup bot, you could then go for another switch or exchange bot as well. So you could break that down into two discrete pick lists of 12 or more, or you could break it down into one discrete pick list of 24 plus. So being able to go into the competition with a rough idea of who you would like to partner with and what that those robots you would like to have is very important to be able to have. You want the drive team to have a cohesive strategy in mind even before you get there. And so scouting alliances we have found to be very helpful with this. In the past 3 years, I don't remember a single event where we've gone that we haven't been able to find another team that was willing to scout with us. And especially with all the match scouting and then hit scouting, it becomes very difficult to have all of your students involved in the process. And it's a huge level to carry. And so what we end up doing is, especially these past few competitions, we've had upwards of 6, even up to 10 different teams working with us, which makes it a lot easier on the students, and they're now able to go hit scout, just talk to teams and get a better idea of teams and their strategy as opposed to just the teams by the numbers. And beyond just scouting with other teams at your event, it's now possible to get more data from even more events using all of the Green Alliance and then Open Scout and a bunch of other online scouting alliances. So going into something like the district championship, it is possible for you to have extensive knowledge of every robot on the field, even before your first qualification match, which can give you an unprecedented advantage over most of the teams there. So we've done just that. So this past year, the Green Alliance, we've had a little over 30 member teams with us, collecting entire data from over 18 plus events. We've also had some other data collected from pre-competition live streams that are also included. Based on all of this, we've been able to collect data on over 450 teams in our database. So that is something that's very helpful going into the district championships. I know we've had data coming in from all over the New England region. We've had data from the Chesapeake region. We've had data coming in from regionals from California to Australia. And so we've had a total of over 5,400 individual match performances recorded prior to the World Championships. From all these, we've extrapolated almost 125,000 individual data points, which is a lot to look at, but it's really helpful in being able to see the trends in the competition. So putting together a scouting system like that requires some plan beforehand. So early in the season, we ended up contacting a bunch of other teams just to get a feel for how many teams we have at each of our events that we were going to, and also to incite more help on the development side of things. So we started this toward in the middle of the summer, started getting a base for our scouting out done. So we'd be able to go into the season prepared. We started talking to teams everywhere and just trying to get as much data as we could. So we ended up having a base app ready to go in mid-October, November, that we were then able to modify for the competition season. We got all of our teams onboarded throughout November and December, and then January hit. So the first week we ended up having an open debate on our Slack organization, collectively decide what metrics to collect, which is very important. Oftentimes, many metrics are overlooked throughout the season, and being able to pool from over 40 different people really helped us get a better idea of what the competition could really look like. So going into this, we knew we wanted to have a system that could work completely offline, but also online, and that would foster sharing data. So in terms of our database, we ended up using CouchDB, which is a NoSQL JSON database, which supports syncing in a variety of ways. So compared to the typical teams here using stuff like MySQL and traditional databases, CouchDB allows you to set up your database on a computer at the event and also in the cloud, and both of those can sync whenever they're connected to the internet. And this can happen across multiple events. We've had, especially in New England, we've had events running at the same time where they're both running offline, and towards the end of the night when students return to their hotels, they connect their computers to the internet, and suddenly we have data streaming in live from both of them going to the cloud. And even more so this year, with all the events offering event Wi-Fi, teams have been able to upload live data in. This is even more important coming to events like the World Championships. You can have data stream from completely different fields as you start preparing for something like Einstein, which is awesome, I know. And then in terms of software for the app, we wanted to have something that could work on a majority of devices, including students' laptops and phones, but at the same time, teams' tablets. So we put together a web app in HTML5 and JavaScript using Twitter's Bootstrap user interface. And we wrapped it in a Cordova plugin, which allowed it to be used as a native app on the team's tablets, but also for students to be able to pull up the app so they could scout on their phones, which was crucial for some of the other teams that didn't already have hardware. Being able to get more data that really helped. In terms of syncing, we supported Wi-Fi, cellular, Bluetooth, and Ethernet to support a majority of the teams. I know we missed QR codes, which Bluetooth is better. So as far as how we did it, we ended up going straight from CouchDB on the laptops and tablets to the cloud server, which we had running in Azure. Or you could hook your laptop up to a local Raspberry Pi through a network switch via Ethernet, and it would store locally on that CouchDB server. So you could have up to six tablets or six laptops hooked up to that Raspberry Pi, and you'd be able to run the entire system offline for the duration of the competition. And if it were an Android tablet, we also supported a Bluetooth workflow where they could go through to the Pi. Towards the end of the competition, of course, you can sync everything from the Pi back to the cloud, and it's available for all of our teams. So I'd like to give a special thanks to all of the teams that scouted with us this past season and their help in the development efforts too. I'd like to give a special shout out to Scott Young, a former 4909 alum and 125 mentor who's really helped out this past season with getting the Green Alliance rolling. And also to Alexia Rubin from 3467, the Women Mind Up, who's been helping a lot with outreach. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here. So this is a short screenshot of the app. So as you can see, that's the URL, if you guys want to take a look at that later. And over this past season, we ended up using a lot of data tables extensively, just to be able to rank, so you can rank by any given metric or multiple metrics if you'd like. And with that, I'd like to give a quick demo. So as you just saw, this is the app. You can key in the event code. So all of this stays pre-populated. So this would all be filled in when you're handing it off to your scouts before the match. So for instance, if we were to scout 3467 in match two, and quarterfinals, 499, scout initials, RR. It takes you straight through and walks you through the separate phases, which we've found to help scouts a lot, as opposed to some of the paper scouting sheets, electronic, really really helps guide scouts through the process, especially if they've never done it before. So for the autonomous period, they ended up crossing the line. They did the right side auto, and they got one on the switch. So now the scout can click next, and they can track the robot as it goes through the match. So in this particular match, let's say they put two cubes on the switch, one on the scale, and then three on the exchange, and they were able to place very accurately on the switch and the scale. So something that we actually forewent this season was Commons text box, because in the past we found that very difficult to analyze. So we ended up, as I mentioned in our Slack group, being able to have a lot of ideas in terms of metrics and strategy. We tried to come up with a bunch of preset comments that scouts may have so we could go through them and qualitatively analyze them. Because stuff like reckless driving, which unfortunately does happen from time to time, and then accurate cube placing, which was especially important as we got to the two-layer and even three-layer stacks on the scale, if a robot were disabled or if the robot was top-heavy, all of that really factors in to how that robot performs on the field. So being able to collect comments in this regard really aided the process in being able to analyze all of our comments effectively. And as for the end game, they did make it onto the platform, and we're going to say they were lifted by partners. So that's basically buddy climb, similar to how 125 or Mechanical Advantage does it. They can pick them up, and that way you can analyze specifically how a team climbs, and it's much more than just the data that you can see on the Blue Alliance. Although something like this would count as the team not climbing themselves in a typical scenario, being lifted by partners kind of helps you see that they didn't climb themselves because the fact that they were lifted above by another team, they're getting the same points. And as I mentioned earlier, there's also a bunch of preset comments to help aid scouts walk through the process. So if this were a real match, at this point we'd click finish and it would be in the database. And since we're in the convention center connected to the Wi-Fi, all of this data would be instantly available to all of our member teams. So as for how we were able to break down the data, we had the team averages for each event. So by that, this is the Australian Southern Cross event, and this is team 4802, being able to see how that robot performed at that given event. So this is an overview of all the different metrics that we just keyed in the previous screen. In addition, we wanted to be able to see it averages throughout the event, just to get a set of baseline. So for that same event, you can see the line cross and all of the other metrics that we just collected. So this is really beneficial in seeing how far above the bar teams really fall, especially at competitions that you haven't been to. This helps see, okay, team 499 was particularly on the scale repeatedly in this match, but there also seems to be not as many cubes on the switch throughout this entire competition. So that it's really helpful to be able to correlate the data like that. In addition, we had global team averages. Just throughout the season, having data being pulled in from so many different places, we really wanted to be able to see in how a team performs throughout the season. So for, say, 499, we've been to three events this season, and this is our fourth. So we can see across all of the events what our total average was, and you can compare that to the averages at a given event to see how we've increased over the past season. So say if we look up 499, of course you can see our line cross and then all the auto breakdowns, teleop, and then all the separate comments. So this is, as I mentioned earlier, this is something that's really crucial, being able to see all of these percentages is much better than text box, which we've tried in the past. It's really hard to analyze. And of course, being able to see the individual matches is also very important. As much as we like to see a high-level picture of the overall data, there are just those moments where you want to at that particular quarterfinals match and see what went wrong there and how you can improve for the next match. And with that, where do we want to go next? We're looking to get in more teams. As I said earlier, we've had more than 30 teams with us this past season. We're currently in talks with Open Scout and some other large scouting alliances. And we're hoping to start recruiting more as soon as the end of competition. Going into the off season, we'd like to have a lot more help development-wise too. This year we had a strong focus on being able to collect all of the data. And although we did have all the tables to try to break down the data, we weren't able to get into the more advanced features such as these heat maps where you can see a team comparing their switch cubes to their scale cubes and to see how teams fall on that spectrum throughout a competition. And in addition, graphs can help you see things like consistency throughout the event. And we're also looking to add in picklist creation utilities to assist in scouts being able to look through the data throughout the competition, even before that, as I mentioned earlier. Something that we've also considered, and I know a bunch of other teams have been doing, are custom ranking metrics. Because although it is nice to be able to have your own subjectivity to your pick list, there's always those niche things. Being able to have a pick list that a preliminary pick list created by the system itself is nice. So you would be able to say for your first robot, we're looking for a scale bot. So that is 75% of the criteria that you're looking for. And then you want to factor in your climbs is another 20%. But you also want a robot that's capable of doing the switch. So that corresponds to the remaining 5%. So being able to have all the custom ranking metrics like that can get you a somewhat preliminary pick list that you can then tweak to your liking. Of course, none of this can be done without all of your help. We need more teams involved, we need more developers. I'll leave this up for a sec, but that is the link to join our Slack organization and our GitHub. So in our Slack organization, we have a channel for every competition we've been to. We have channels for development, metrics, just general strategy. And so in comparison to just talking within amongst your team, being able to get out, I think over this season was very important. As I learned a lot of other strategies from other teams that you wouldn't even think of going into the season. And on our GitHub link, you can find all of our code if you'd like to go through that. And of course, we use GitHub issues, so if anyone would like to pitch in, that would be much appreciated. We'll have more about that in the off season. Do you guys have any questions?
With multiple teams contributing, did you ever have times when multiple teams were scouting the same match, and did your system have a way to check for potential erroneous data?
So this year, we did not have a way to check for erroneous data. However, we did end up giving all of the scouts within TGA a brief how to scout document, so basically 5-page crash course on starting from the basics of power up, how all the scoring is broken down, all the different components of the game, and then annotated screenshots of our app, and then a little bit of practice with the live stream. So most of our scouts are very well prepared. At competitions, as I mentioned, we also have Slack channels for each of our events. So we continuously maintain contact, and we work with the other teams. So say we have 6 robots on the field to scout, if we're working with 3 other teams, we'll try to get 2 scouts from each team, and that significantly decreases the load. And that's 4 more scouts you can now send to the pit, or to help fix your robot, or just to talk to other teams, and anything like that.
With your pit scouting, there's a lot of words and not a lot of actual numerical data points. How did you try to incorporate, like, strings into the data sequences that you were having up there, because it's often 2 entirely different types of data. How do you put them together?
So that I just had students take notes on paper. We ended up using it a lot more last year. This year we didn't integrate it into the system because we thought just being able to see that is more beneficial. A lot of the times it doesn't help so much so in terms of the alliance selection itself, but mostly in mass strategy. That's where I'd say it pays off more so, and between competitions. So in terms of mass strategy, that's just checking to make sure what autos they can do, from which side they can go from. Can they go for the switch, can they go for the scale, the exchange, and knowing that breakdown was very important to get back to our drive team, so we could put together what we would call an effective strategy, and to say this team can do the left scale very well, this team can start from the right, and if the switch is on their side, they can do that, and we have the best shot of getting center, so basically maximizing your abilities.
Just touching on the data error question, we have electronic scaling system. We only have 6 scales, we don't have a whole universe of data to pull from. But when there's such a small sample size, a small error can really mess up your averages. So somebody misunderstanding how to scout, or maybe transposing the switch and the scale on the survey or something like that can really mess up your data. So have you found that gathering a lot of data from a lot of different teams that things kind of average out?
Yeah, we found that most of that goes away for the most part. Something that we've considered is there are ways to deal with this, so that's something we're looking into for next season. So this includes comparing it to the Blue Alliance and the official FMS data, so seeing how, although the Blue Alliance does not give you team-specific data, it gives you alliance-specific data. So you can compare how all of the robots that you scouted, how much they did on the scale compared to the Blue Alliance, and you can kind of flag that and say, the Blue Alliance says that they did 15 on the scale, but our match data says they did 20. But in terms of the switch, it seems flipped. So it can flag that, and then the scouting captain can look at that. And there's also, you can use the standard deviation to try to be able to see that throughout. So that is something we've considered, and with more development on board this year, hopefully we'll be able to go into that.
Say somebody completely messed up or just didn't scout, would you be able to just drop a match's data from your database so it doesn't affect the averages at all?
So this year we didn't have a way to do that in the interface, just because that's a slippery slope, especially with all the data that we have, and being able to give that ability to teams to just start deleting data from the database, if you know what I mean. So that's something we are considering doing, having at least certain people on certain teams that can delete the data. So just like say the scouting captains or scouting leads on each team have ability to delete the data, or at least mark it for deletion so it stops counting it in the averages, and then the team can go through them and make sure those are actually unintended and we can deal with that. And something else is, instead of just completely deleting it, we can flag it and have someone else in our alliance look through that as pre-competition scouting or even just training and try to get that same data. So that's something that we've found that having more teams really helps, and just being able to fix all the data. You can just have one of your scouts just go through one of the past videos and just go through it, and you have better data. Could you repeat that, please?
So, especially at large field events like this one, how does the Green Alliance handle distribution of workload between different teams so that you're not overlaying kind of all the sets to make it more optimized to get the
teams? Yeah, so what we've done is, at the New England District Championship, we had a few particular teams running it. So there was Team 5813, Morpheus, and Team 4909. And we were kind of coordinating with all the teams there. So we ended up using 4909's hardware, and all the teams we put together in a giant spreadsheet and gave them breakdowns and shifts. So for the first 8 matches, 4909 would be contributing 3 scouts, 5813 would be contributing 2, 58 would be contributing 1. And we had a breakdown of that for every 8 matches or so, going all the way up through the eliminations round. So that really helped that. So at events that we're not at personally, we delegate like a sponsor team, which again contributes the hardware and then helps arrange all of the logistics at the competition. Yeah.
But you mentioned something about, this team would be responsible for 3 of the robots, and the next team over there would be responsible for 3 of the robots. How are you communicating, how exactly are you communicating the data between the teams so that both have access to it? You have people constantly running back to the pits?
So we've been doing all electronic through our apps, and typically it's just one team's hardware at event.
So you all need to sit together?
Yes. So we just have a special section for scouting, and we've found that that's actually beneficial. We've had students from other teams just start talking strategy between matches. And of course, you don't want to give away your team's edge per se, but just throwing ideas around, thinking, oh, what that team just did in that match is really cool. Maybe that's something we could try later on in the day. We found that to really foster some new strategies, and that's been great.
What do you guys do about a team that's maybe usually high scoring, but in one match is being more defensive, or spamming and blocking for the robot, so spend more time doing that? Or if it's a robot that's doing that, and it's usually high scoring?
So with that, that does pull down the averages. So if we notice something like that, typically, like some teams you know are going to always be towards the top. And so if we notice that a team that we expect to be towards the top is not, we start looking through the individual competition matches and see where that trend really happened. If that's multiple consecutive matches, so like I said earlier, like if a team's climb over the break or their elevator, being able to pick up on that and then go talk to them, that's what we typically do. And so that's where. Yes.
Can you flash the link to the last page on the screen?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So to actually see the data, you will need a key as well. So once you get on the Slack page, you can feel free to reach out to me and I can get you guys set up with a key. Without an access key, you can use the app and visibly just to key in some practice matches, but again, we try to keep it a mutual relationship with our member teams, so we try to mandate that you contribute at least some data to get some out. So at the end of the season, we may consider opening up that data for the community, but.
How should we contact you to talk about that?
You can talk to me after the presentation. Yeah. Yes, so that we've considered actually making a match dashboard, which we started and we weren't able to complete in time for this competition season. So the only issue with using the Blue Alliance is they're all Alliance-specific data, so it's hard to really see the breakdown. So what we were considering is, again, using it more for error checking and being able to pull in the match schedules and all and hand it off the drive team, being able to tell them your next match is at this time on this driver station, this color alliance, and these are the teams you're with, these are the teams you're against, this is what your alliance can do, this is what that alliance can do, in terms of all the individual breakdowns, in terms of the score, and it can give you, you can even go as far as to say, this match you are less likely to win, so that drive team can take that as an advantage and say, okay, this might be our match to go try some new strategies, and see where we can go with that.
Do you have a way to show the match results? Because I've seen in my scouting that there are teams that have the ability to do 6 or 7 cubes on a scale, but they've, throughout a whole competition, never really shown that they can do that because they haven't had to do that because they've never faced that competition from opponents.
Yeah, so that's something that we found to really help with having data across multiple events. So we've seen teams not do much at all at the competitions out there with us, but we look through the trends from their past events, and the data speaks for itself. Some teams try to use pit scouting data for that. My only concern with that I've had is sometimes it can't be as accurate. So that's always something you should take with a grain of salt. And typically, what we found is if a team doesn't do it as much in the competition, it could be either, like you said, it could be due to not having as competitive opponents, or it could just be due to, say, a change in their drive team, or even just a change in their gearbox for other reasons. So pit scouting is helpful for that. You're probably better off going to talk to them and try to understand why that number has changed so drastically.
Is there a way to customize when you get your data, such as you only want to see just scale switch and bulk, so that you can customize so that you can only see what the teams have done there?
So as of now, we do not. So all the data, as you saw in the demo, is shown. You can sort individual columns and multiple columns in that itself, but right now there's no way to turn off columns per se. So that's something we'll probably add in for next season. In addition to, like I said, about the development, having heat maps and graphs, we're thinking just having some drop downs and letting teams be able to pick what data they'd like to see. So say the top five metrics you want to see in a table, or the two axes you'd want to see in a graph, and to allow teams to really customize their metrics.
Yeah, kind of taking off on that, do you allow your Alliance team members to access all the back-end data raw?
Yes. So all of that you can see in the interface. We also give them access to the database. So CouchDB is connected directly through the browser. There is no API server, so that's worked out really well. The access keys that we give our scouts can be used to log into this, but also to log directly into the API. So if teams are interested, they can directly hook up their own applications to the API. So that's something 3132 did using the data for their data, putting together a dashboard to get them more into the insight into the data. That's totally something that's feasible. Yeah.
Throughout the season, first of all, did you find, after the second week, we all go, oh shoot, we missed that thought. We should have been collecting that data too. Did you find anything you needed to change or add? And did your database system handle changes mid-season well?
So this season, we've tried to avoid changing it. However, last season, we ended up changing it quite frequently. We changed it at least once per competition. At the New England District Championship last year, I think I changed it like twice or thrice throughout the competition.
During
the competition. So I will say the app is designed to be very easy to adapt. However, our only concern with changing it throughout the season is our scouts at this point. Because now we're with over 30 plus teams, each with so many, we're at the point where we have hundreds of scouts. So trying to retrain all those scouts multiple times throughout the season is an immense task. I know even training scouts on your own team over and over again, it's just once you get used to it and doing it dozens of matches throughout, it's really hard to change that.
Did it mess up your data? Like your data analysis? For instance, okay, after the first week, we realized that we didn't want to just collect how many cubes on the switch, but how many on the home switch versus the opposing switch. And then we realized that our data from week one wasn't meshing with our data from week two, different system. Did you have any conflict, changing data?
So,
because it's cumulative.
Yeah, so that is always something to consider. We had that issue last year. So we try to at least make changes that can easily be transitioned into the older data. So running through the analysis program, all the older data has a filter applied to it that extrapolates that data out. And so if we were to look through the analysis, say for your particular example, the home versus opponent switch, it would say for that particular match it was not available. And then you can be able to see both data at the same time.
It didn't throw a wrench in it, it just was not available.
Yeah.
That's nice to know.
They just not count it in the averages. Because otherwise, there's potential to mess up your data, say if you just count it as zero.
Yeah.
So we found actually that the likelihood of that has decreased significantly throughout all of the talks we've had with other teams in forming what metrics we'd like to collect. We ended up having thousands of messages sent in our Slack server over the first week about, can we scout this, can we scout that? And that particular question actually showed up, home versus opponent switch. And we collectively, we ended up putting together a poll, and teams just said, we don't think it's worth it. The scale seems more prominent. And that's more of a qualitative thing that your node scouts can take. But for the majority of the data, it just complicates it for the scout. So we found that being able to try to do it beforehand works out much better as opposed to trying to change the data format after.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there a way to see data from a specific competition?
Yes. So you can see all the events and averages. So this weekend, they weren't able to scout as much for this particular event. So we got some data, but as you can see, this isn't a comprehensive set. So if you wanted to look at the New England District Championship, we have a significant amount of data. So you can pull together exactly what data you want to look at, or say you want to look at 4909, you can see at each competition we participated in and how the numbers add up over time. So although there is a lot of data to look at, you can easily pull out the data you want to look at. And so something that we've been actually been considering more so for next year is being able to filter out more of this data, because early in the season we didn't actually expect to have this much data coming in and having the need to filter it out. Something we've considered and something that our database supports is a filtered type of sync. So you can say your particular team is interested in your first two district events and then your district championship and some of the world's divisions, and that's all that you'll sync from the database. And so you're not being cluttered with all that, but at the same time, all of your data is synced beyond. Does that answer?
Geographically, you mentioned this is kind of centered, or this Green Alliance is centered in New England and stuff.
Yeah.
So if you, are you planning on expanding it geographically to like the Midwest or?
Yes, so we're actively seeking more teams to join. So it just so happened that most of our teams we're familiar with, we're from Massachusetts, so all the teams around us, we just ended up trying to bring in, and most of our teams are from there. But like I said, we've got 31-32 from Australia, and then a couple other teams from there. We've got some from California. We've got a Canadian team or two. And we've got a few from Chesapeake. So all together, yes, we would like to add more. Our ideal goal is to be able to have data from every single event. And being able to come into Houston or Detroit and to know before your first qualification match, I know how that robot's going to perform. I know how that alliance is going to perform. Be able to tell your drive team, this is when your first match is. This is the individual breakdown of how you're going to, how you can compete with them. And so, yes, that's something that we would like to do. Yeah.
So the way our scouting works right now is entirely offline on Android tablets.
Okay.
How do we set it up to work with?
So more info on that is on our Slack. So in terms of Android, if you wanted to do it via Bluetooth, you do have to install the app. If you want to just do it via Wi-Fi or cellular, then you can just use the web edition. The website edition, as I mentioned, works on any device. So from your phone to your laptop or to your team tablets. Without the need for Bluetooth, there's no need to go for the Android version. The way the app was designed is so it's the same exact interface running on both, so students are more familiar with the interface, especially between competitions. So like I said, in the Ravens district, we've had the scouts that center district competitions. We didn't have to train scouts from other teams to working with us because they'd already had exposure early on in the season. Anything else? Okay. Thank you guys.
Mm-hmm.